begin with an excerpt. So here it talks about, in a robust democracy, reality, however inconvenient it might be, finds its expression both in the speech of the leaders and social forms, and it talks about media. So which of the following is the best, which reflects the crux of the passage? That means it says that it is through the media as well as the argumentative articulation and deliberate democracy. That means responsible media should not distort the reality of democracy would be the correct answer. So A would be the correct answer. The next passage talks about interconnected home devices, and it says that with these interconnected home devices, there is a very, the companies are trying to bring it very thin profit margins, and they gather a lot of personal data regarding the person, and this actually turns the home into a corporate storefront. Now the question says, which of the following most logically represents the message in the passage? The knowledge of the consumer leads to more capital expenditure? No. The knowledge of the consumer talks about economic development? Nothing has been mentioned. Interconnected devices improve quality of life? It has not been talked. Interconnected devices can be at security risk, and home users may have privacy risk. That is clearly mentioned here, that it could turn a home into a corporate storefront because they observe the consumer behavior and understand their needs and preferences based on it. So D would be the right option. The next talk about sustainable practices. So green growth talks about rethinking the growth strategies and its impact on environmental sustainability. So how it focuses on has been focused. So it says that resource intensive and energy intensive processes would need to make the way for more efficient development strategies in order to avoid an economic debt. Now, which of the following correctly reflects the crux of the passage? So environmental sustainability is inimical to the objective of achieving a high growth rate. That is incorrect. That is basically it's saying that it is not required, but in actual reality it is required. Poverty eradication, nothing has been mentioned. So maintaining high environmental standards is a prerequisite for steady, sufficient and inclusive growth. That is a correct statement which has been laid down here. And with large population, rampant poverty, this has not been talked about, right? Now the next question is an interesting question. There are distinct values of x and y. X and y are natural numbers. X into y is 12. So what could be the factors? 1, 2, 2 and 3, right? Now with this only, I cannot say what is the unique value of x and y. But when I'm saying x divided by y, so I have to take it as 6 divided by 2, right? So that is 3 is odd. Now if I use both these statements together, then only I can say that this would be correct. So I cannot say this can be answered by this alone. But if I say x and y alone are sufficient, I don't know what is the x and y. Now, what are the unique values of x and y can be determined only when I know x and y, x multiplied by y is 12. Then I can know the factors, and then I can find out the factors in the x and y terms to say that it is odd. So both the statements are required to answer this question. The next question is, y received 4 by 5 of what x received 4 by 5 of y of what y and z is. So x is equal to 4 by 5 of y plus z, and y is equal to 2 by 7 of x plus z. Now the question says, who receives the least amount? Now to find out the least amount, I can have the value of y substituted here. Okay, if we look it onto it directly, I can say x and y, there are x, y and z, there are three variables and two equations, I cannot solve it. But if you look onto it carefully, I can substitute the value of y here. That would be 2 by 7 x plus z plus z. 4 by 5 is equal to x. Now what I can do here is, I need not to calculate, I am to say who receives the least amount. So I can find the ratio of x, y and z. Now, if I am able to only find out the ratio between x, y and z, I can say who would receive the least amount. I need not to find out the absolute values, and only ratio would do. So with these two statements, I can find the ratio. I cannot find the absolute value, but yes, I can find the ratio. And therefore, together these two statements are sufficient to answer who would receive the least amount. So both of these statements are together required to answer the respective question. So coming on to the next question. Now this question is a direct question. It says, if the average mark are 60, I want to find out what is the number of students in the class. Just with highest and lowest marks, I cannot say how many students are there. There can be 3, there can be 5. So this statement is not sufficient to answer it. Exclusion of highest and lowest does not change the average. Again, with this statement, I cannot say. So neither of these statements actually would lead me to the answer here. So none of the statements, so question cannot be answered even by using both the statements together would be the right option. The next question is, there are 3 distinct prime numbers whose sum is a prime number. Now, I know that their sum is less than 23. So what could be the numbers? I can have 2, 3, 5, 7, 11. Then I can have 13, 17, right? Now, I want to say that their sum is less than 23 and one of the numbers is 5. Now, first of all, 3 numbers, if I am adding, I cannot have 2 as the option because as soon as I add 2, it becomes an even number. So, I remove 2 from the calculation. Now, what are the numbers left? 3, 5 and 7. I add this, okay? There are 3 distinct prime numbers whose sum is a prime number. Now, what are those 3 numbers I have to identify? Now, if I add these 3 numbers, will it turn out to be a sum which is a prime number? So, as I said, if I add 2, then it does not remain a prime number. Now, I add 3 plus 5 plus 7. So, it becomes 15. 15 is again not a prime number. Now, what I do is, I add 5, 7 and 11. So, 5, 7 and 11 makes what? It makes 23. So, the sum is not less than 23. So again, these 3 numbers cannot be there. Now, if I add 3, 5 and 11, so 3 plus 5 plus 11, that is 19. Okay, 19 is a prime number. So sum of the numbers is prime number. One of the numbers is 5 and their sum is less than 23. So with these two statements, I can identify the 3 numbers as 3, 5 and 11. So this becomes the case where I require both the statements to solve this question. Now, so can be answered by using both the statements together and not alone, right? Now, this is a question. If x plus y is an integer, can I say that is x plus y is an integer if I have an information that 2x plus y is an integer? Now, fractions and decimals are not integers. So, let me assume x is equal to 0.25 and y is equal to 0.5. Now, if I take 2 into 2.5 plus 5, I get 1, which is an integer. But with this value as integer, I cannot say whether x plus y would be integer. So statement 1 alone is not sufficient. Similarly, if I say I reverse the values, I make x as 0.5 and y as 0.25 and I do the same thing, then again I cannot say is x plus y an integer. So both these statements are not sufficient to answer that question. Even if I consider both these statements together, I cannot say x plus y is an integer. So here I have the statement that p plus q plus r is equal to 50 and q is 16, which is the least one. So what is p plus r? P plus R is 50 minus 16, that is 34. Now, the question says the cost of P is not more than that of R, right? So, what could be the possibility here? What could be the values here? It could be 17 and 17. It could be P is not more than R. So, R is greater, so it could be 18 and 16. Now, important to note, I am saying P is 16, which is least. So, it's not clear from the question, but if we assume that there can be one more number which is at the least value 16, then P, I can say the cost of P is not more than R. If I say cost of P is not more than R, then this can be one of the options, right? And this can be one of the options. If I say the cost of R is not more than P, When I say R is not more than P, that means R is 16 or R is not more than P. Okay, that means the value of R is small. So R is 16 and this is 18, or again it could be 17. So if I use both these statements together, I can say what would be the final price of the article P. So with both the statements, I can conclude the price of the article P, but independently with one statement, I cannot conclude it. So both the statements in this case would be required. The next question is, P, R, Q and S appear in the test. P scored more marks than Q. That I have to identify whether it is correct or not. Now if I say P plus Q is equal to R plus S, and on the other side I say P plus S is greater than Q plus R. So I take it on the other side, P minus Q is greater than R minus S. So I have two equations, P plus Q is equal to R plus S and P minus Q is greater than R minus S. Now even if I have both these statements, I can have a value which is negative, so minus 2 and minus 3 could be there, or I could have 20 and 10 as here. So I cannot, even with the use of both the statements, I cannot say whether P has scored more marks than Q or the marks of Q are more, and therefore neither of the statements together, even both the statements together, cannot justify the question. The next question is pretty interesting. It talks about conventional classrooms. Now it says that conventional classrooms simply emphasize on the fixed duration. 1 year gone, you move to the next class, as simple as that. And it does not matter, some may outshine, some may not, and some may be left behind. We end up with less than 10% employability of the graduates and half of the formal education, right? So with this information, which of the following is best reflected? In the conventional classroom, the goal is learning rather than attainment of competency, that is correct. And the classroom encourages one size fits all approach and does not focus on differentiation, right? So both of these statements are correct as part of the question which is given, the passage which is given. The next is, based on the above passage, which of the assumptions have been made? As the large number of workers are employed in the unorganized sector, India does not need to change the conventional system. No, it is not. It cannot be revealed or it cannot be assumed here. And with the present conventional setup, India produces a sufficient number of skilled workers to realize the demographic dividend. Again, that has not been mentioned. Coming on next, it says that as a child turns into a teenager, there is a conflict between the child and the parent. Child wants to manage their own affair on their own go, while the parents want the power to be there, and they usually actually focus on their own opinions, which are dogmatic. Okay, so based on this, what assumptions can you draw? The adolescent do not feel comfortable with the parents because they tend to be dominating and assertive. That's totally correct. Adolescent of the modern times do not have respect for the parent. This is nowhere mentioned. So one only would be the correct option here. The next is, which of the following statement best reflect the central idea? Now here, the parents in general may not be much help when the children are on their way to becoming adult. That is correct. When the children reach adolescent, involvement of the parent is unnecessary, that is not related. Nuclear family has not been brought, and adolescent turning stubborn is not mentioned in modern society. So A only would be the correct option here. So coming on to the next question, the number of fives used in a book numbered from for 260 pages would be how much? So if I'm using from 0 to 95, so 0, 5, 10, 15, okay, sorry, I have to count only 5s, okay, so 5, 15, 25, so on till 95, so there are 10 such numbers. Then from 105 till 195, there are again 10 such numbers. Then from 205 till 255, there are 6 numbers. So how much? 26. This, now from 50 to 59 in this series, okay, so 50 to 59, there are how many fives? 10. Okay, then 150 to 159, and then again 250 to 259 would be included, because that's there. It's still 260 pages. So 10 plus 10 plus 10 fives here, 30 fives here, 30 plus 26. So 56 fives would be there. So this is the correct answer. Now, this is a direct question on the sum of the first 28 terms. So here, this is the first term 1, then 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 4, 3, 2, then 1, 5, 4, 3, 2. So this is the first term, second term, third term, fourth term and fifth term, right? So I need to have sixth term and seventh term. Together, I would have the 28 terms which would be there in this set. So seven sets I would take and each of them would have, combining all of them, I would have 28 terms because till here I have 15 terms and then I have 13 more terms, so 28 terms in all. Now, 1 is across 7 of them. So 1 is across 7 of them, right? 2 is across 6 of them. 3 is across 5 of them. 4 is across 4 of them. 5 is across 3 of them. And then 6 is across 2 of them and 7 is across 1 of them. Adding all these, I get 84. You can simply do the calculation and solve it, right? So this is a direct question there. Now, this question, I take P, Q and R. Now, I say R is 20% more than Q. So let me take Q as 100. So R would be 120 and P would be 25% more of it. 25% more of it, that means 30 more. So adding that, 150. Adding all this, it gives me 370. So 370 would, P would give me 3330. So solving that, if I get the value of P, now P would be 150 of the value that comes in. Okay, 150 of the X that comes in and this would be 1350. You can simply solve this equation and get the answer done. Okay, the next question. This is a really interesting question. I have to find out A, B, C, D. And the sum would be 1CE. Now, C and C have to be equal. That's important. So, if I take A is 0, okay, then I can have C and C as equal. But A cannot be 0 because I am having 1 carry over here. So, this possibility I cannot have. Now, let me take as A as 9. Now, if I take A as 9, I take 2 here. So, this would become 1 and this would become 1. But this C and C should remain the same, but here I get 2 and 1. So this 9 cannot be possible, but this value of 9 can be possible only in one case where B and D, when I'm adding these two, I get a carryover. And this carryover of 1 comes in here. So when this carryover of 1 comes in, this A turns out to be 10. And this can be the only possibility where I get 1 here. And I get the same value of C and C in both the cases. Correct? So, A here would be 9. I can determine it. It cannot be determined as incorrect. A can be determined, but A would be 9 only when B and D add up to give a power of 1 carryover. But that would be done because I have to have here 1CE. I can have 1CE, I can fulfill this requirement only when this 1 carryover comes in. Because this C and C otherwise would not match. This C and C would match only when 1 carryover comes in and A, which is 9, with that carryover makes it 10. So this last digit becomes 0. So C and C would remain the same and this 1 carryover would carry over again. So A would be 9. Very, very interesting question. Now, the next question is, I have to have 7 natural numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay, such that I say X, Y and Z, okay, I keep X, Y and Z, right, so this is 7 greater than 2 into 3 greater than 3 into 1, okay, so this is 7 greater than 6 greater than 3, that is correct. I can have this as 7, okay, I can have this as 2 and this as 1. So 7 greater than 4 greater than 1, this is the second possibility. Now focus on what are the values of X, Y and Z, right? Now let me take this as 6. So 6 greater than 2 into 2 greater than 3 into 1, that is another possibility. And again, I can have 5 greater than 2 into 2, which is 4, greater than 3 into 1. These are the possibilities. But because I cannot have 3 here with 6, I cannot have 3 here with 5. So those possibilities cannot be ruled out. I cannot have 1 here because 1, if it comes in, and 1 here, this would become smaller. So there are 4 possible triplets that can be formed. So 4 would be the right answer here. The last question for this set. The total cost, understand this question carefully. So the total cost of 4 orange plus 6 mango plus 8 apple is equal to twice the cost of 1 orange plus 2 mango plus 5 apple. Now I remove the 2 from here and remove 2 from here. So this gives me 3 orange plus 3 mango, sorry. 2 orange plus 3 mango plus 4 apple is equal to 1 orange plus 2 mango plus 5 apple. This is what is given here. Solving these two equations, I get orange plus mango is equal to apple. Now, this is the cost of 1 orange and 1 mango is equal to the cost of 1 apple. This I have obtained simply by simplifying this equation. Now, the question talks about the second one. The second one here, let me write it here. Okay, so here it is 3 orange plus 5 mango plus 9 apple is equal to 4 orange plus 6 mango plus 8 apple. Now I, instead of apple, I keep it orange plus mango. So I put it as orange plus mango here, and I put it as orange from orange plus mango here, and I simplify on both the sides. When I simplify on both the sides, I get this as 12 orange plus 14 mango is equal to 12 orange plus 14 mangoes on both the sides. So I can say both 1 and 2 would be the correct statement. So this was another question that we have solved. We'll meet up with the last set in the next lecture. Stay tuned. Thank you.